Welcome to worship at Hollywood United Methodist Church. We are glad you have joined us for this Sunday in Epiphany. Let us now join our hearts and our minds together as we worship God.
In the silence of our hearts or in spoken words, let us give thanks for the gift of this day and pray for the life of the world. Gracious and loving God, we gather together in gratitude for all you are and for all we have. As we gather in worship, we remind ourselves that our service today is a vehicle of resurrection, a time of refreshment for all. May our homes be places of hospitality and hope, that we may know your risen presence as we share our lives in this virtual space. May our worship bring honor to you, joy to all, and healing to our land. You teach us to let the peace that comes from Christ rule in our hearts. May this be so. When we forgive in words, allow your Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with peace, keeping out doubt and uncertainties. With gratitude, we draw closer to you and let go of unforgiveness. With gratitude, we can see all others as beloved children of God and see your image reflected back to us in each one of them as it also shines from us, loved and accepted. Help us always to find the compassion that comes with true forgiveness. We bring our problems before you today, God, as we pray for all those affected by COVID-19. Those who are suffering in hospitals and at home, those who have passed into glory, and those who are mourning the loss of loved ones. The physical, mental, spiritual, emotional, and financial burdens are great on so many, and we know that not everyone is affected equally or justly. We pray especially for those who are risking their lives for the protection and sustenance of others, and we pray with and for those whose voices often go unheard. We ask that you will look upon those who the world tries to look away from. May they know especially that they are heard, that they are held, and they are loved. May they know your truth in a world full of lies. May they know your protection in a world full of violence. And may they know your abundance in a world full of poverty. No one child should have to fight so hard for the inheritance that you so freely gave to all. We have so many things which are challenging in our world today. Staying safe at home, wearing masks, and waiting for the vaccine all seem to be weighing heavily on us. Help us to live with patience and grace towards all. Our challenges can make our emotions more intense and less easy to navigate. Help us to remember, God, that you are walking this journey with us and through us. May we be vessels of your peace to all those we encounter and also to ourselves. We ask all this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, as we say together the words he taught us. Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come and thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
We're so glad you've joined us for worship this morning. We hope you will take advantage of some of the other opportunities that we have online for study and for service. You can check all those out on our Facebook page or on our website, which you can find those links in the chat. There are a couple of announcements I want to call your attention to. One is that Lent begins on Ash Wednesday, February 17th. We will be having a special service that evening at 7:30. And we want you to be able to experience the fullness of Lent, even though we're going to be online during that season. You can sign up to receive Lent in a bag, and it will be mailed to you. There's a form in the chat that you can fill out now, or again, on our website or on our Facebook page. And also, during the season of Lent, we offer daily devotionals written by folks who attend the church. So if you would like to write one of those, I still need 22 people to write, so if you are willing to do so, please email me at RevKathy@HollywoodUMC.org, and I will send you a scripture base and a due date. All that we do here is made possible by you, by your prayers and your presence, your service, your witness, and your financial gifts. We encourage you to give as generously as you are able so that we might not just simply maintain our ministries, but grow them during this time of being online in the heart of Hollywood, in Toluca Lake, and online. God bless you.
Of your fellow man, lend him a helping hand, put a little love in your heart. You know it's getting late, oh please don't hesitate, put a little love in your heart, and the world will be a better place, and the world will be a better place for you and me. Just wait and see. Another day goes by, but till the children cry, put a little love in your heart. If you want the world to know, you won't let hate grow. Put a little love in your heart, and the world will be a better place. And the world will be a better place for you and me. Just wait and see, wait and see. Take a good look around, and if you're looking down, put a little love in your heart. And I hope when you decide, you let conscience be your guide. Put a little love in your heart, and the world will be a better place. And the world will be a better place for you and me. You just wait and see.
Matthew 18, verses 21 to 35. Forgiveness. Then Peter came and said to him, Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as seven times? Jesus said to him, not seven times, but I tell you 77 times. The parable of the unforgiving servant. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. And as he could not pay, his lord ordered him to be sold, together with his wife and children, and all his possessions, and payment to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, "Have patience with me, and I will pay you everything." And out of pity for him, the lord of that slave released him and forgave him the debt. But that same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii. And seizing him by the throat, he said, "Pay what you owe." Then his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, "Have patience with me, and I will pay you." But he refused. Then he went and threw him into prison until he should pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their lord all that had taken place. Then his lord summoned him and said to him, "You wicked slave, I forgave you all your debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you?" And in his anger, his lord handed him over to be tortured until he should pay his entire debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or your sister from your heart.
Today we continue our Epiphany sermon series entitled Forgive. We know that we're going to need a lot of healing in this coming year. Healing from the pandemic, to be sure, but also healing from the divisions that have threatened to tear apart our nation over the past few years, especially over the past few weeks. For healing to truly take hold in our lives, we really have to start with forgiveness. We began this series by talking about the differences between secular or therapeutic forgiveness, a forgiveness that places us and our feelings as the motivation for forgiving others, and Christian forgiveness, which calls us to forgive not based on what we feel, but rather on who we are, beloved children of God, filled with God's unconditional love and grace, which was affirmed at our baptism. We then talked about the importance of forgiving ourselves so that we make room for God's grace to enter our hearts and give direction to our lives. Last week, we focused on forgiving the past, those stories and incidents from our lives that can drown us in negativity if we continue to hold on to them. Today we're focusing on forgiving others, on the personal relationships that we need to forgive in order to truly and fully heal. So I'll start with a story. It was about 2003, I think 2004, Mother's Day weekend. I had made an appointment on Saturday with the guy who'd cut my hair for at least 15 years by that point, Danny Ray. And I went in and got my hair cut and colored, like always, on a Saturday morning. Except, I knew Danny needed glasses, but he was refusing to get them. Okay, he did my hair, got cut. As I was preparing to pay, I noticed in the mirror, I said, "Danny, my hair looks a little bit reddish." He said, "No, it's just the lighting in here. I've changed out the bulbs." Okay. Walked across the street to my car, got in it, looked in the rearview mirror, and oh my goodness, my hair was really red. I called him from my car and I said, "What's going on?" He said, "Don't worry, it's fine. It's a new brand. Don't worry." By the time I got home, my hair was no longer red. It was magenta. It was orange. It was not the pretty purple that Reverend Denyse has, because we all like that and have, at least I have some envy over it. No. This was bad. It was really bad. Now, at the time, we had a colorist in the congregation, and so I called her, and I said, "Is there any way you can work me in today, because I'm supposed to preach tomorrow for Ed?" She said, "Of course. Come on out." So with the boys in tow and my yellow pad writing my sermon on a Saturday, we went out and I sat and had my hair redone and redone. Well, I didn't go back to see Danny that entire summer. And finally, I made an appointment and went back to see him. And I remember walking into the salon after not having had a haircut for 3 months, the longest stretch I've ever been until 2020. And I walked in and he started crying and he put his arms around me and said, "I'm just so sorry. Will you forgive me? I'm so glad you're back." And so we went and we sat for a while and we had a long conversation, not just about that, but about other things that had been building up in his life, in his family, things that he had neglected to take care of. And so as his friend and his pastor, I talked, he listened, which for Danny was really something. And then it was forgiven and we moved on and he continued both to cut and color my hair and show me the box with the proper 507N, not R, notation on it every time until cancer took him from us in 2018. This morning's gospel lesson from Matthew teaches us how to create a culture of forgiveness. Jesus tells us clearly how we are to practice forgiveness and reconciliation. First, Jesus says, when we have been hurt, we are to be direct with the person who has caused the hurt. As your pastor, I can tell you readily that I would rather be talked to than talked about. And I'm guessing that's true for many of you. Amen? I hear the amens. If you have a problem with someone, Jesus says, go to them directly and try to work it out. And if that doesn't work, then take someone with you. The point is, don't let the problems fester. We help ourselves and we help our community when we lovingly confront those who hurt us. When we seek reconciliation from one another, by definition, we are not following the ways of the world, which teach us to seek and destroy the ones who would hurt you. No, instead, we are choosing to follow the Christ. Second, we need to remember that we can't expect forgiveness if we are not willing to offer it. A hallmark of Christian forgiveness is offering mercy to those who have hurt us. Remember, Christians forgive not because it makes us feel better. We forgive because we ourselves have been forgiven, and we choose to live as forgiven people. Our reading from the 18th chapter of Matthew deals with the very issue of withholding forgiveness. And the basic message of Jesus is don't do it. Third, we need to recognize that forgiveness is just not easy. It's not something for the faint of heart. As Gandhi says, it takes a strong person to forgive even when the offender is repentant. And even if those who have hurt us refuse to acknowledge that hurt, we're still called to love. Jesus didn't say, love your enemies except those that hurt you. Jesus didn't say, love those people who are easy to love. Jesus said, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. You see, by definition, loving implies forgiveness. Loving does not excuse behaviors. True love holds others accountable for their actions, even as it encompasses forgiveness. And forgiveness is always a process. It's never a one and done. Professor Greg Jones from Duke calls forgiveness a craft, like it's the practice of medicine. The craft of forgiveness, he says, will necessarily take us years to perfect. Well, Jesus gave Peter the formula for that craft. If someone hurts you, don't forgive them only 7 times, forgive them 70 times 7 times. Even if it takes you years, Jesus says, forgive them completely. We who have been forgiven by God simply cannot hold on to the same standards that the world has for forgiveness. Then Jesus follows up his answer to Peter with a parable. And we know in Matthew's gospel, parables don't usually end well for someone, and judgment then looms large in their background. In this case, Jesus tells a story of a king who is owed a debt by his servants. At the moment when the king expects to be paid, one servant is not able to pay, and as a result is about to be sold with his wife and children. The man pleads with the king and begs for more time. And the king, he decides to have mercy on him, and he forgives the debt completely. But then that servant does not extend the same mercy to a fellow servant who owes him a debt. And when the king finds out, he reinstates the original debt and has the servant tortured until he can repay it. Now, this parable is far from a perfect analogy for us, but in a hyperbolic sense, it does illustrate how God's mercy comes to us even without pleading. And then it outlines the potential consequences we have when we fail to extend mercy and forgiveness to others. A few years back, Chris Dorsey wrote in the Christian Century that the parable illustrates how seriously God takes forgiveness. In any case, what seems to be at the heart of the matter in the story and within the paradigm of sin and forgiveness is this: the failure to forgive disrupts, distorts, and ultimately degrades community. Now, not all forgiveness is created equal. Let me offer a strategy that will both allow us to differentiate situations which require forgiveness and then consider a process for doing so. First, we need to forgive those little annoyances that get under our skin on a daily basis. Think about it. Someone speaks unkindly to us or sends us a testy email. We have an argument with our beloved over something that's completely inconsequential. The behaviors of our coworkers, even over Zoom, are somehow grating on our nerves. Now, for these types of annoyances, we can choose to forgive without requiring any repentance because pretty much it's on us. After all, our coworkers will not know if they're being annoying necessarily. We can forgive and we can let go of our stress over them. We can pray for patience and tolerance and the ability to count to 10 in a variety of languages. But we also need to realize that there are times we get stuck right in this place, having trouble forgiving those little things because dealing with the bigger stuff, we just don't want to. Now, second, there are such egregious behaviors that forgiveness cannot happen without repentance, and only then with the hand of civil justice involved. Now, for this, I'm thinking primarily of domestic violence cases or other criminal acts that directly affect us or those we love. My heart aches for so many women who have been counseled to forgive and return to abusive home situations. So let me be very clear. As Christians, we are called never to condone and always to denounce abusive behavior in no matter what form. Amen? Forgiveness in those situations can only happen after the abuser repents and the person abused has time to heal and go through a reduction in trauma with a therapist and find a place of peace and justice, which takes time. Now, the third category is where most of us struggle with forgiving others. It's that vast middle of behaviors that we live in. Behaviors that hurt and anger and alienate us. And we don't want to hang on to them, but forgiving is just, it's just really hard work. So, for example, betrayal by a lover or a coworker or a friend. Theft of property, theft of credit for work done, theft of the opportunity to advance due to the behaviors of others. Misunderstandings based on lack of communications or differing or changing priorities in a relationship or a work setting. And then there's sloth. When there's an unwillingness to exert the energy, to do the hard work it takes to maintain a relationship or a partnership. Adam Hamilton, the pastor of the United Methodist Church of the Resurrection in Kansas City, says that when it's time to forgive others on these sorts of issues, there's a fourfold process that can help. And pneumatically, it's called RAPS, R-A-P-S. Number one, R, remember your shortcomings. As you consider how the other person has hurt you, think about your own actions, your own short-sightedness, and how it may have hurt others. Essentially, remember that none of us is perfect, that we all fall short of God's glory, even though we remain God's beloved children. Second, A, assume the best of the other. Remember the totality of your relationship. Don't get stuck in just one issue. Number three, P, pray for the other. Pray for healing and wholeness for you both. And then finally, S, seek to understand what shaped the other person. That does not excuse hurtful behavior, but sometimes if we understand the why of someone's actions, it can make it easier for us to forgive. And then the choice is yours. The tattooed and sometimes salty Lutheran pastor Nadia Boltz-Weber recently wrote that maybe retaliation or holding on to anger about the harm done to me doesn't actually combat evil. Maybe it feeds it. Because in the end, if we're not careful, we can actually absorb the worst of our enemy, and at some level start to become them. So what if forgiveness, rather than being a bleep way to say it's okay, is actually a way of wielding bolt cutters and snapping the chains that link us? What if it's saying what you did was so not okay, I refuse to be connected to it anymore? Forgiveness, she writes, is about being a freedom fighter. And free people are dangerous people. Free people aren't controlled by the past. Free people laugh more than others. Free people see beauty where others do not. Free people are not easily offended. Free people are unafraid to speak truth to stupid. Free people are not chained to resentments, and that's worth fighting for. Well, Nadia's words remind me of a closing story. When Bill Clinton asked Nelson Mandela a question, he said, Nelson, when you were released from prison, as you marched from the cell block across the yard to the gate of the prison, the camera focused on your face. I have never seen such anger and even hatred in any man as was expressed on your face at that time. That's not the Nelson Mandela I know today, said Clinton. So what was that about? And President Mandela's response was this: I regret that the cameras caught my anger. As I walked across the courtyard that day, I thought to myself, they've taken everything from you that matters. Your cause is dead. Your family is gone. Your friends have been killed and now they're releasing you, but there's nothing left for you out there. And I hated them for what they had taken from me. But then I sensed an inner voice saying to me, Nelson, for 27 years you were their prisoner, but you were always a free man. Don't allow them to make you a free man, only to turn you into their prisoner. So family, my prayer for us this day is that we not become a prisoner of bitterness and resentment. Let us instead choose life. Let us be reconciled with one another. Let us practice the craft of forgiveness with others, for that is the only way to live as the people God calls us to be. Let us be more intentional in living and loving as Christ taught us, striving every day to create God's beloved community here on earth. And let's just have one pastor with purple hair. Amen.